What is office politics and how do you navigate it? This is a topic we got from one of our viewers who left a comment for us to address this topic. And I'm going to be joined by Paminas to discuss it and help us, guide us on how we can navigate office politics. My name is Cynthia Wakio, and as usual, I am joined by Paminas. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Cynthia, for having me.
So when you hear office politics, help us define, or rather help us know what politics is and how does it manifest in itself?
Yeah, like you said, this is an interesting topic because it's not tangible. So I wouldn't say there's one definition of what office politics is. But the way to have a better understanding of it is when you look at how it manifests itself. And based on my experience, I would say there are three ways office politics manifests itself. Number one, it's the power plays. For example, at senior level, who is reporting to who has the resources, who has the budget, who has the say, or even who has the no. And sometimes you'll find like even the senior management fighting on, oh, who's going for this training, whose team is being funded, you know, who's making the decision. So power play. Then you find the other form of office politics is relationship-based. So this is where, let's say, you and John, you exclude me, you know, or vice versa, two departments fighting, you know, or even it could be who do you go to lunch with, who do you connect with, who do you, over the weekend, who do you meet with after work? Yeah. So this is more of relationship, communication-based, and people form cliques based on, you know, who they are, their passions, their interests, and such kind of things. The other one, and which is even more serious, and you don't want to be find yourself in this, is where now someone is doing something to advance, and these are people who will step on you. They are people who it's cutthroat. They'll do anything it takes to be able to, you know, have an upper hand over someone. So here we are talking about career growth, advancement, promotion, salaries. Yeah, so someone will use office politics to get ahead, and not necessarily based because of their competences, because of their skills, because they're bringing something extra to the table. But they're using underhand tactics to be able to get to the next level. Yeah, so I would say those are the three ways that office politics manifests itself. Number one, power-based. Number two, relationships. And the last one is, what am I getting? Whether it's the opportunities, the promotion, the salaries, it's etc.
Yeah. I find that people confuse conflict and office politics.
Yeah.
Help us differentiate between the two.
So the way I look at conflict, for me, conflict is it's more professional. We are disagreeing on something. For example, so we can come and say, it. Sometimes and it could be petty. For example, we can say, oh, okay, Cindy, next time don't wear that top. It's specific, it's tangible, But office politics, I can come here, I'm smiling with you. But then in the afternoon when I'm talking to John, I say, oh, guess what? Hey, that lady, sioni akiwa na future huku. You know, or why did you even hire her? I don't see her adding value. Hasn't she ever done a video before? You see, it's personal. So conflict, you'll find it's out there. People don't hide. You know, they'll say, I don't like you. I don't like the way you work, I don't want you to be in this project. It's more direct. But office politics, you'll find people try to hide with niceties, they'll try to be your friend, and yet they are working to your downfall.
So referring back to the comment that was left in our channel, which I'm going to read out loud. I work in an office where I manage a team of 25 people, but there's this lady who is always arrogant. She shouts to anyone who crosses her line, and her argument is that she has a senior person in government who can protect her and she can't be fired. She even shouted at me, yet I am her senior. She comes to work late, and I have really tried to talk to her without achieving any tangible results. Please advise. So what would you advise this person?
Yeah, it's quite an unfortunate position, because putting myself in the shoes of that manager, I mean, you are supposed to be empowered, you know, to make decisions, and yet you're here, there's a staff who's misbehaving and you can't take action. So for me, there are two ways to look at it. Number one is culture. And us as readers, we are the ones who define culture. So I'm not saying that you can't have a professional relationship with a subordinate, but that does not have to compromise the relationship that the subordinate has with the direct manager. So let's say maybe we come from the same estate and we meet on Sunday, I see you in church and I say hi to you, Cynthia. It doesn't mean now you undermine your direct boss because you know where I live, maybe we interact socially.
Yeah.
No. So you, as the boss, as the MD, as the PS, as the CS, is to make sure that, well, here, in terms of culture, it's one based on respect. So it doesn't matter what kind of relationship you have up and down or, you know, down up. It doesn't matter. So culture, I'll look into that because for me it looks like it's a culture issue. Because for someone to be so
audacious
to say that I can't be fired simply because I know Mdosi, so that means the culture, they know that it's allowed to behave that way. Yeah. So the second issue is about structure. Because, and you can see it has somehow also closely related to culture. So structure is where people respect each other based on the seniority. Yeah. So again, a junior staff has no business, you know, having an exchange with a manager. It shouldn't happen. So those are grounds even for dismissal. In fact, when it comes to the Employment Act, gross misconduct is if a junior employee does not follow a lawful order, the boss, they can be summarily dismissed. That is, they can be dismissed without notice, without a warning, because now this person has closed the line.
Yeah.
Yeah. So for me, those are the two things. And it's to look at the culture and to look at the structures that you have and be able now to enforce those structures. Yeah. However, if you, as this manager, you look at the situation and the culture is, I would say, toxic. Because as a manager, you can't change a culture.
Yeah.
Unless you are the business owner, unless you are the board of directors, unless you are at the very top. You as a manager down here, if you look at the culture and you see, well, this is the culture you have. As long as a junior staff knows a boss, there's nothing that can happen.
Yeah.
Then I would say you are fighting a losing battle. And if I were in your shoes, the decision I would make is to work on an exit plan. Yeah. Because you're not going to win.
Yeah.
You're not, yeah. Yeah, because if the people at the top don't see the importance of people respecting each other,
yeah,
not even based on position, they may respect. Because even as a manager, it doesn't mean I talk down on a junior staff.
Sure.
Yeah, so respect cuts both ways. So if the people at the top, they don't see the need for people to practice respect in the organization, then you have no business being in that organization. Because when will you do your work, and when are you going to teach them about respect, Cynthia? Yeah, so you'll find that you lose in one way. Yeah, you spend too much time trying to teach them respect or trying to inculcate respect in the organization. And then when you're doing all that, you're losing out on your performance.
Yeah.
Yeah, so for me, I would exit. Yeah.
And also, it also informs the tone for other employees. They see what is happening.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's not also just one this staff, because if the other staff see, oh, okay, so someone can be rude to you, they can undermine you.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't, from there, you can't stop it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what advice would you give professionals to successfully navigate office politics?
Number one is to accept that politics is a way of life. It's within us. Even in a family, you always, especially if you're meaning in the family, kids, you always think, oh, there's one or two who's favored by either mom or dad. That happens. Or if the parents themselves, there's one child they get along with. So it's a way of life. It doesn't matter whether you're working for government, a top private organization, an NGO, whether you're working here at corporate staffing, there's office politics. So, but what matters is the level of office politics. Yeah. And then second, for me, I would advise someone, it's good to know, to understand the dynamics, but don't get involved. Because what happens with office politics, remember like the example I gave about relationship. You could be having a fallout with another colleague, but I don't know how. The reason why, so imagine if I come and I want to put myself in the mix.
Yeah.
Then you guys, you go up, you make up. What happens to me now, 2 months later? Yeah. So it's just to be conscious that, yes, office politics exist, but don't get involved. Yeah. That's what I would say.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let things play out.
Mm.
Yeah. But as a manager, I would say if this is affecting your work, rarely will things change. So the advice would be just exit and find an enabling work environment. Yeah, because even when I say that, yes, office politics is a way of life, the degree matters. The institutions which I would say office politics is a way of life. For example, government. People know that government, regardless of the hierarchy, regardless of the structure, some junior people have a lot of power. Drivers, secretaries, office messengers, they have a lot of power. Yeah. So you ask yourself, are you the type of person who thrives in such institution? Yeah. If you're not, then you have no business working in government. Some private sector, some institutions also you find the stakes can be high. I will give you an example. There was a CEO of a major hospital who was dismissed, not because he didn't have what it takes. And I don't want to mention the hospital, but it's in the press. So this CEO was dismissed because the board members wanted to, for him to allocate or give one of the projects to their preferred supplier. So that's a form of office politics. That's power. So when he said no, I mean, they didn't confirm him. Based on that, purely based on that, his performance was very good. Yeah. So what I mean is you've also got to look at the institution and get to understand, you know, apart from the job they are giving you, there are things which are, they may not be out there.
Yeah.
So it's for you when you're doing your due diligence, what kind of an institution is this, how do they operate, and what is the level of office politics would you expect? And then look inwards and see, I as Cynthia or I as Paminas, where do I thrive? There are people who are really good at office politics, and there are others who, let me do a good job, I go home. So if you thrive in office politics, then you can survive anywhere. If your character, personality doesn't allow you, then you also have to be very careful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stakes are high. Either way.
They are very high, yes. You have, so it comes, I guess, maybe then it comes back to you and the environment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. And there you have it. If you'd like us to talk about something that is really bothering you and affecting your career, leave a comment below and we'll address the topic. And for more tips about your career growth, interview, CV, this is the channel you need to subscribe to. Please share this video and we'll see you next time.